This Windows 10 client triggered me as it left the impression of just being a very compact but still ordinary PC on the inside. And obviously it is originally featuring Windows XP embedded, however booting it from the internal flash failed right away. Then my restoration journey ultimately led me into assembling my own version of Windows XP embedded. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. This thin client was produced by German company IGEL Technology. IGEL is the German word of hedgehog, and while the present logo is maybe a bit too abstract, the contemporary company logo was a playful representation of the hedgehog. Said that, IGEL specialized in thin clients until they gave up their hardware business in 2022. By the mid-2000s, when this product was current, IGEL produced thin clients that ran on Linux as well as Windows CE and Windows XP embedded, with prices per unit ranging between 350 and 500 euros. The unit I have was originally supplied with Windows XP embedded, although as noted before, it didn't boot anymore. When opening up the device, you'd see the flash device right here. It sits on a 44-pin IDE socket and is reported by the BIOS as a 256 MB device. And as you can see from here, this device doesn't just look like an ordinary but scaled down PC, it actually is a real PC built around the VIA Eden platform. The BIOS battery seems depleted, but it can be easily replaced. That's definitely necessary, as even so the system reports a 400 MHz via Eden CPU, the CPU for this model should actually be a 600 MHz one. And it definitely is. The via Eden was based on the C3 and C7 line of CPUs. With a smaller footprint and lower performance rating, these were typically going along with via EPS series mainboards targeted at embedded devices. And when looking at the mainboard, it's imminently clear this is based on the EPR platform, however it seems to be a custom board not matching any of the ones found here. Still, as it's obviously a more or less standard type PC, it should be possible to resurrect this. At this stage, I thought to equip an ordinary compact flash card. I kept the original flash disk on module in, but obviously the CF socket seems to take precedence over the DOM module if both are connected. Even so, the DOM has a jumper for setting ID primary or secondary mode, it doesn't seem to have an effect. I had hoped for the CF card to become the primary and the DOM the secondary ID device. But as it seems, when populating the CF socket, it seems to entirely disable the 44-pin socket. Setting this aside, I hooked up an external USB floppy drive. This worked like a charm to install MS-DOS, and obviously this little machine runs Doom pretty well. However, I don't want to run DOS on this machine, but make it a Windows Terminal client again. Of course, it's possible to install a vanilla Windows XP to this machine. It won't fit neither onto the factory installed DOM nor a 512 MB or 1 GB compact flash. But it works well when using a 2 GB compact flash card. But that's also the biggest catch. You'd install a full-blown Windows XP, whereas for a terminal client you can leave pretty much everything away. This is where Windows XP embedded comes into play, as it can be fully customized and trimmed down to suit even very small footprints of below 100 MB. There was no way for me to get back the original boot image for this machine. Also, you can't just slap any Windows XP embedded image to it, as XP embedded has to be custom built for every target machine. Said that, I went along to install the Windows XP Embedded Studio into a virtual machine. The eval version for Windows XP Embedded still floats around the web and comes on 3 ISO images. It brings a comprehensive install guide, and basically you must install an SQL database engine, the components database and the actual Windows Embedded Studio. While you can use MS SQL Server, that is not a requirement, the MS SQL Desktop Engine will do as well and comes bundled. The components database includes all the Windows components selectable from the target designer. The latter is the tool to define the XP embedded base configuration. It has several sets of so-called design templates, which can serve as a starting point. I'll go with the terminal design template. This will ask for certain extra components right away, like the general system type or some base drivers for the disk subsystem. But this is still very generic, and it is recommended to take a system configuration dump from the target system. You can do that using the target analyzer utility found inside the utilities folder. ta.exe is a DOS command line utility which will run from plain DOS. I initially went with this one for a system components readout. This will create a file with a .pmq extension which can then be imported into target designer to add the required hardware drivers for the target system. So I imported it into target designer, which caused a lot of system devices and drivers being added to the image. It would complain about some drivers being missing. Luckily, it's indicating the PCI device ID. An online search pointed me at several websites where you can look up the actual human readable device name. Now, the via API is long gone, but I was really surprised to find the driver still being accessible on the via website, even for Windows XP embedded. Injecting the drivers is a bit more complicated, as you have to use the component manager to import the drivers. XP embedded drivers come with a SLD file, which can be imported to component manager. Once I had all potential via drivers loaded, I went back to the target designer and re-imported the devices.pmq file, which this time round didn't complain any longer about missing drivers. A brief side note here. You may have observed that in the meantime I was working on the EagleThin SP2 configuration file. I did the entire procedure once before on the vanilla XP embedded. One issue I observed was that even so the NT-bootloader NTLDR was selected as a component, it was never copied over to the target image. The target images, which you'll find beneath C:\Windows-embedded-images, are essentially nothing else than the file directory structure for the new Windows XP embedded system. It is supposed to be copied as is to an NTFS or FAT formatted disk, be that a hard drive or, like in my case, a compact flash card. Said that, when booting off a FAT medium, one would be required to run sysprep first from DOS to make the target disk bootable. This would set NTLDR in the boot record, however, as it was always missing in the first place, my thin client would complain about not finding NTLDR on startup. This problem went away once I installed XP Embedded Service Pack 2. Once the Service Pack 2 components were installed, the target configuration can be updated to Service Pack 2. And indeed, this time round, NTLDR was no longer missing. This gave me big hopes for booting into XP Embedded at this point. but to no avail. While it did start initially, it would always end up on a blue screen. The dreaded inaccessible boot device. Now it's clear this is related to a yet missing driver. But I took the configuration dump before and I added all the necessary device drivers. But obviously, something was still missing. And even the manual says that the DOS-based target analyzer may occasionally miss some system devices and it's recommended to run it from Windows instead. Now, the good thing is that the first Windows XP embedded CD-ROM is actually bootable. So I burned the ISO image to a coaster and tried starting it. However, that version of Windows PE probably didn't include all drivers as well, as it always stalled at the same stage during the startup sequence. And it totally didn't expose that behavior when running inside a virtual machine. So that's why I ultimately installed Windows XP directly to the machine so I could run the Windows-based target analyzer. This is the tap.exe utility, which comes as well from the XP embedded utilities folder. And in direct comparison, it becomes imminently clear. While the devices.pmq file I captured from DOS using the ta.exe was 17,000 bytes in size, the tap_devices.pmq file was captured from Windows using the protected mode tap.exe and is significantly larger. It seems to directly read out the configuration as seen from Device Manager and thus provides a more complete representation of the hardware configuration. And by the way, don't make the mistake to run the DOS mode ta.exe on Windows XP. As you see, it's only some 3000 bytes in size because its detection capabilities are limited by the virtual DOS machine on XP. In any case, use tap.exe to capture the configuration. Said that, I went on to create a new revision 3 image based on the latest device configuration. And this time, there was no longer blue screen, but XP embedded started into FBA, the first boot agent. This essentially configures the pre-built image as a runtime image on the target device. Once this is done, XP Embedded is ready for use. As mentioned, this was built on the terminal client device template, so a lot of the usual Windows functionality was stripped away. This would show itself here and there in missing icons, non-functional control panels and more. One could of course build a more complete UI with the typical Windows XP style, but this significantly blows up the storage footprint. While the initial image was around 150 MB, the one with the Luna weighs in at over 200 MB already. And even more if you want the functional control panel items. Still, that's lightweight when compared to a standard XP install, which accounts for around 3 GB on XP Service Pack 3. Yet, I went through another iteration to add some functionality to the image, like Device Manager, so I could verify if the drivers were all correctly installed. And apparently, the graphics device driver was not. Even so, it was correctly included with the target configuration, it would never work. Looking at the actual directory containing the files, I noticed it also included some extras, in particular the help files. On an earlier occasion, I had noticed that XP Embedded does not really include the help files by default and the Windows help is basically unavailable. As most components offer to include the help system if needed, I suspected that this wouldn't work on this driver. So I went to simply edit the .inf file of the driver package and remove the install section for the help files. After refreshing the driver in the component manager, I rebuilt the image. Voila, that obviously made the trick, as this time the graphics driver was correctly installed from the get-go. From the target designer, it's also possible to create the system default passwords or add new user accounts. I used that to create an unprivileged account. You can also fully customize the menus and add or remove certain functionalities. The dependency checker will ensure nothing breaks by re-adding required dependencies. This way, I could build a runtime image that includes a fairly trimmed down but still functional UI, including Device Manager, some games and the Internet Explorer alongside with the Windows Terminal client. And this definitely comes close to what the original XP embedded, as it was found on the IGEL Think client, originally may have looked like. That leaves me with just one thing left. So far, all my trials and tribulations were carried out on the compact flash. And that's for a good reason, because if you watch closely, you'll notice the DOM has a female header. And that totally doesn't go with the 44-pin USB drive adapter I have, as the 2.5-inch disk drives usually have male connectors. So I had to improvise using jump wires. I even had to remove the plastic housing from every second wire, as otherwise I wouldn't have been able to connect them all. But it worked, and the DOM showed up on my Mac, so I could transfer over the Windows XP embedded image. Once I reseated the DOM, I reinstalled XP embedded one last time. Because now I'm ready for my next endeavor, which is to connect this one to a Windows Terminal server. But that's a story for another day. What was your experience with Windows XP Embedded? Were you a developer, or did you just come by XP Embedded as a user, be it on terminals or maybe point of sale applications? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today.
Oh, and by the way, if you're asking yourself how to support me and this channel, consider looking on my wish list for retro gear or a channel membership subscription. This would allow me to bring you even more interesting topics in the future. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.
Next on the Vintage Collector. I thought it to be an easy ride. Windows XP's smaller brethren, Windows Essentials for legacy PCs. But just when I didn't expect it, it was right there, yet another odyssey about missing drivers and the dreaded inaccessible boot device blue screen.